Hi guys, today we're going to be talking about biomineralization, the part 5 video that I've made now over biomineralization. In this video, we're going to be talking about the rest of the biologically controlled biomineralization processes, as well as fossilization. And if you didn't catch it, I'm actually wearing my ammonite earrings for the occasion. So let's get started. Just to recap the first biomineralization video, there are two main types of biomineralization: biologically induced mineralization and biologically controlled mineralization. In the part 2 and 3 videos, we talked about minerals that form from biologically induced biomineralization. But in the part 4 and this part 5 video, we are talking about biologically controlled mineralization, which is a process in which microbes actively control both the nucleation and growth process of mineralization. And to do this, they typically have an intra or intercellular site or locus of mineralization and bring ions or sequester ions into this site, where then they expose those ions to certain organic ligands in a controlled manner to begin nucleation and grow crystals at a certain orientation and structure even. So it's a very biologically controlled process and a really cool one. And the last time we talked about magnetite, greggite, and amorphous silica biologically controlled biomineralization. But in this video, we're going to be talking about calcite biomineralization, and then we'll talk about fossilization, which is not actually a biologically controlled mineralization process, but it's also not always biologically induced. And so it kind of fits in its own category, and I didn't know where to throw it in except this part 5 biomineralization video. So here is where we're going to be talking about it. Anyway, to start with calcite or calcium carbonate. Calcium carbonate represents the largest fraction of biologically controlled biominerals on Earth. And the most widespread deposits actually come from microorganisms, which you might think is odd because there are also a lot of other things that produce or secrete calcium carbonate skeletons or shells, such as corals, mollusks, sponges, a lot of invertebrates that we've talked about in the paleobio videos, but the largest deposits are caused by microbes. This is so cool. These microorganisms include algae, such as coccolithophores, and protozoans such as foraminifera. I have a video on Forams. I'll link it up here if you want to check it out. I'm also currently making a video about coccolithophores and other microfossils. If you want to check that out, I'll hopefully have it out soon. But in terms of the calcium carbonate deposits these microbes cause, they basically remove calcium carbonate from the seawater to make their shells or tests. And coccolithophores specifically are really abundant in coastal surface waters where they receive enough sunlight for photosynthesis. They do have to photosynthesize because they are algae, and so they do have to live in the photic zone. But in no way does this limit their extent. Coccolithophore blooms can reach up to several thousand square kilometers. Here's actually a phytoplankton bloom seen from space in this image here on the bottom left. And these organisms might even be important for mitigating global warming, because not only do they remove carbon from the atmosphere by photosynthesizing, but they also produce something called DMS, or dimethyl sulfide. And this acts as a cloud condensation nuclei, aka clouds can form because of it. And this greatly increases Earth's albedo. Albedo is just surface reflectivity. And so reflecting sunlight really helps to cool down Earth as a way of mitigating global warming. But what about forams? Forams can live at the surface water, but because they don't have to photosynthesize, they can also live on the seafloor. The ones that live in the water column are planktonic forams, and the ones that live on the seafloor are benthic forams. And these forams can comprise of over 90% of deep sea biomass. That's insane. And due to their distinct shell morphologies, they have been widely used as biostratigraphic markers, which is something we talk a lot more about in the foram video. But how do forams and coccolithophores actually build their calcite shells? Well, in the case of coccolithophores, they have an internal vesicle, which acts as their locus of mineralization, like we talked about in the general biologically controlled mineralization process. And this vesicle is then filled with calcium 2 plus ions that they pump into that vesicle from the calcium-rich seawater in which they live. And they pump these calcium ions through specific channels in their membranes. And then once in the cell, it's thought that specific transport enzymes grab onto those calcium ions and take them to the vesicle. But they also pump in bicarbonate ions which then can react with the calcium ions to produce calcite. It's thought that they use bicarbonate rather than CO2 because CO2 is their limiting nutrient for them to photosynthesize. So instead they use bicarbonate, and through this reaction of bicarbonate and calcium ions, they produce hydroxyl ions. And these ions react with hydrogen ions within the vesicle, maintaining an alkaline pH favorable for calcification. So this just means they're maintaining a pH in their vesicle that favors calcite production. But this isn't the only thing that coccolithophores control in the vesicle. They also control the size and orientation of the calcite crystals that form. How insane is that? I just think that's so cool. Foram calcite production is not as figured out as coccolithophore calcite production is, but it's thought to be a similar process to the coccolithophore calcite production process. Basically, the forams are thought to transport calcium ions and CO2 from the seawater into their cells through specific transmembrane or membrane proteins that are like pumps and channels for the calcium ions and CO2 respectively. And then the calcium 2+ and DIC, which just means dissolved inorganic carbon or CO2, are actively transported, probably via transport enzymes, to the site of calcification. The nucleation is thought to begin with organic templates, so organic ligands that act as templates for adsorption and nucleation to begin, that are employed by the foram. So again, biologically controlled at the site of calcification. And so we can see the main difference here between the coccolithophore calcite production process and the foram calcite production process is that forams probably use CO2 rather than bicarbonate ions. And that's just because CO2 is not a limiting nutrient for them because they don't photosynthesize. Moving to fossilization. And again, guys, I have to break it to you. This is not technically a biologically controlled mineralization process. As you can imagine, once an organism has died and it comes time to fossilize it, well, it either gets degraded and not preserved, or it can become fossilized and preserved in the rock record. Once it comes time to fossilize it, that organism is dead, so it can't be controlling the process of mineralization. Instead, the process might be biologically induced, or it might be kind of different than both bio-induced and biocontrolled mineralization altogether. But the modes of fossilization we'll talk about today are thought to be at least biologically induced. So in terms of what becomes fossilized, what types of organisms, typically those are organisms that have hard parts. So we know that macroorganisms like invertebrates that we talked about in the paleontology videos that have hard parts or shells or skeletons can become preserved relatively easily if they're subject to rapid burial. But microorganisms, which is the general theme of these geomicrobiology videos that I'm making, rarely become fossilized because microbes don't typically have hard parts. We did see some exceptions to this in the previous few slides where microorganisms produce calcite skeletons or shells. And we also saw some exceptions in the previous video when we talked about silica producing microorganisms like radiolarians and diatoms. However, prokaryotes don't typically do these mineral producing shell skeleton type processes and so don't have hard parts and are really hard to find in the rock record. But even with this limitation, there have been fossilized prokaryotes found in Precambrian rocks billions of years old. So how is this possible? Well, one process we'll talk about today is silicification, which I show an example here of silicified wood, but we won't be talking about wood preservation today. I just wanted to show this example because they zoom in on the spheroidal silica grains that caused the silicification of, and I think these crystals are really, really cool. And so we'll talk about how this process happens and what microorganisms this might occur in. And then we'll also talk about calcification as well as calcium phosphate preservation and pyritization. So let's get into silicification. Experiments have shown that cyanobacteria subject to solutions saturated with colloidal silica at temperatures of around 100 degrees Celsius are silicified within a few months and only show slight alteration to their cells' structures. However, under similar conditions at temperatures of around 165 degrees Celsius, the cells became fragmented and their intracellular components basically destroyed. So how might these bacterial structures become preserved in the rock record for even a little bit, let alone billions of years? Well, experiments have also shown that when grown in silica supersaturated solutions, some cyanobacteria produce thicker sheaths. And so we talked about sheaths as these covers that bacteria might produce over their cell wall. So their outermost layer will be the sheath if they produce it. And they produce this for sometimes protection, but it's not always incredibly clear why they produce it. But some bacteria produce these sheaths that, if present, will become the sites of nucleation for biomineralization processes and then mineralize the sheath rather than the cell wall or cell itself. And so the sheath can act as a barrier if cyanobacteria are living in silica supersaturated solutions, where they want that silicification to stay on the outer parts of their sheath rather than going into their cell. We even talked in the biologically induced mineralization videos about how after these cells lyse or die, the silica mineralization will occur intracellularly. So that means that their production and continual maintenance of these sheaths is really important for keeping that from happening and killing the cell. The other thing that the sheath might do is make the bacterium, or at least the bacterium's outline or structure, more preservable in the rock record if that sheath becomes mineralized. A similar response of these thicker sheaths in supersaturated solutions is seen with biofilms instead of sheaths. We see that some bacteria produce biofilms to facilitate silicification away from the cell as to protect the cell itself from this silicification process. However, in this case, the cell's structure will probably not be preserved. And that's because the mineralization is happening away from the cell rather than around the cell on a sheath that outlines the cell's structure. So how does this silicification process occur? So we currently know three main factors that facilitate the preservation of intact cellular structures by way of silicification. The first factor is the timing and rate of silicification relative to the death of the organism. Rapid silicification is favorable for preservation before decay. If the bacteria remains unprotected or unmineralized for too long, it'll probably degrade or begin to decay at least before the mineralization occurs. And then once it does, that silicified structure will not be the full structure. It will be kind of warped and won't be representative of the cell structure. The second main factor is thick cell walls and or sheaths. Like we just talked about, these contribute to the cell's resilience against degradation and provide a surface to facilitate the nucleation of silica. The third main factor is the binding of metallic ions, in particular iron, to the cell's surface. It's been shown that these metals deactivate the cell's own autolytic enzymes that would otherwise increase the rate of degradation after the cell's death. And these cells that have these sorbed metals on them also can tolerate higher salinities. So these three factors help to increase the possibility of prokaryotic preservation by way of silicification. But what about probably what you're familiar with in terms of fossils, calcification? If you've ever seen macrofossils, at least what you saw was probably calcite or some form of calcium carbonate. However, bacteria don't as often calcify as macroorganisms do. And this comes back to the hard parts, but it is possible for bacteria or microorganisms to be preserved via calcification. However, there's also a process called phosphatization that also competes for the fossilization of these microorganisms against calcification processes. So what do I mean by this? Well, let's paint a picture. When microbial cells die, heterotrophic bacteria contribute to the degradation process of these dead or lysed cells by consuming them. But the metabolic byproducts that these heterotrophic bacteria produce during this process also promotes elevated saturation states and therefore mineralization and mineral incrustation of these dead or lysed cells, therefore simultaneously inhibiting the preservation of some dead cells while also promoting the preservation of other dead cells in the vicinity. So what does this have to do with calcification and phosphatization? Well, these are two common minerals that will become elevated in their saturation states when these heterotrophic bacteria metabolize and therefore are possible encrusters of the dead cells that may become preserved due to this process. And what's observed is actually that calcium carbonate typically encrusts and preserves microbes when the pH is more alkaline, whereas calcium phosphate preserves the microbes when the pH is more neutral. And calcite, as we can see, has pretty coarse grains. So when it does encrust and fossilize microorganisms, it pretty much obliterates the finer details of those cellular structures. Whereas calcium phosphate mineralization actually retains greater detail of the cellular structures and therefore is favorable in terms of a more detailed preservation, but might not actually last as long in the rock record. So it's a give and take here with these different fossilization techniques. And in terms of which one happens more often, it's probably that the alkalinity produced by the activity of heterotrophic bacteria makes calcite a more likely preservation material. And we can see that with the abundance of calcified organisms in the rock record. But something even more durable in the rock record is pyrite. And this rare but possible fossilization method called pyritization can happen in three different ways. One way is mineralized tissues, in which pyrite precipitates in the pore spaces of refractory tissues, aka cellulose and chitin, to produce a really detailed pyrite fossil. However, it can also happen in a coating type of process in which pyrite precipitates on the outer surfaces of the organism and rarely preserves internal structures. And lastly, it can happen as casts or molds in which only the fossil outline is preserved, and this causes the greatest degree of detail or information loss in terms of your fossil. So what you have is pyrite precipitating in the pore spaces of tissues, causing the greatest detail preservation, and then going down in detail as we get to the casts and molds type of pyritization. And I know these pictures down here are not microorganisms, but you try finding images of pyritized microbes, because I cannot. But anyway, you get the gist from these pictures. You have the middle picture here that has this ammonite with detailed suture patterns preserved. So this was probably a more detailed pyritization process, whereas you have these coarse pyrite crystal grains in the picture over to the left. And in that case, you had a lot of information loss. You can't see the suture patterns anymore. You can still see chamber separations, but it's not as detailed. So there's a wide variety of pyritized fossils out there and their degree of detail. And that is all I have for you guys for this video. The major reference I'm using is Introduction to Geomicrobiology by Kirk Kahnhauser. This is linked in my description if you want to check it out. And other contributing references are also always linked in my description if you want to check those out as well. And the upcoming topic on this geobiology playlist is microbial weathering. We'll have a part one video over silicate weathering, carbonate weathering, soil formation, and the climate impact that weathering has. And then we'll have a part two video over sulfide oxidation, bioleaching, and microbial corrosion. And lastly, if you guys are still watching this video, comment down below for me any topic that you would like to see in the upcoming GeoBio videos. Thanks so much for watching, guys. I hope to see you guys soon. Bye. However, in this case, the cell structure